Hey guys, it's me, Miss Miller. I just wanted to show my face and say hello. Hope you're all doing well. This will be the last lesson before spring break. If you have any questions, I'm thinking of doing a Google Hangout Wednesday. So let me know if you're interested. And this will be the second part of Chapter 5, Section 2. And let's get going. I won't be staying around for long, but again, so in this section or this video, we're going to look at all the identities. I introduced you guys to the reciprocal identities. Today, we're going to relook at those as well as the quotient identity and some of our Pythagorean identities and cofunction identities. In addition, we're going to use our calculator. I actually was able to download a graphing calculator emulator, something we didn't have in class. For us to take a look, so hopefully that's helpful. Exit out of here. Okay, so as I said, let's look at our identity. So yesterday, or our last lesson, we looked at our reciprocal identities. Again, sine of theta some angle is equivalent to that same angle as long as it's 1 over the cosecant of theta. Cosecant of theta is equal to 1 over sine. Same with cosine of theta is equal to 1 over secant. Secant of theta is equal to 1 over cosine. Again, theta is just like saying x. Sometimes we'll see it as the Greek letter beta. It looks like a little fish. Or any variable, really. But sometimes it's the letter x. A lot of times we use theta. Tangent of theta is equal to 1 over cotangent. Of the same angle, cotangent is theta equal to 1 over tangent of theta. So these identities are going to be really important. You will have to have these memorized or at least very well known in your memory. And the newest ones we're going to add on today are quotient identities. And they're called that because it's the ratio. So tangent, we know tangent of theta is your opposite over adjacent. And actually that means sine over cosine. We're going to kind of see that a little bit with our Pythagorean identities, how those relate. The same with cotangent of theta is equal to cosine over sine, which makes sense because with our reciprocal identities, tangent is 1 over cotangent. So if we take the reciprocal of sine over cosine, we'll get cosine over sine. So let's see how we can use these identities to help us solve some problems and find all trig values. So given that the sine of theta is 2 over 5, and that cosine of theta is the square root of 21 over 5, we are going to find the value of the four remaining trig functions. So we can target this by kind of seeing what properties we can use. So let's first look at the reciprocal identity, something we're more familiar with. So with our reciprocal identities, we know that the cosecant of theta is equal to 1 over sine of theta. And because we know what sine of theta is equal to, we can just substitute that in. So we know that would be 1 over 2 over 5, which would just mean the reciprocal, which is equal to 5 over 2. So our cosecant, just to kind of clean this up, is equal to 5 over 2. The other thing we can look at is our quotient identity. Knowing both sine and cosine allows us to find tangent and cotangent. So tangent of theta is equal to sine of theta over cosine. I recommend that we write these out as we're working so that helps cement them in our mind. So the sine of theta is going to give us 2 over 5. And we know cosine of theta is the square root of 21 over 5. We know how to simplify complex fractions. So we keep our numerator times our denominator. And we get 2 root 21. And unfortunately, we can't leave it there, so we're going to rationalize. So I have that the tangent of theta is equal to 2 root 21 over 21. You know me, I like to box things. The thing that kind of works for both the reciprocal and the quotient identity, you know that cotangent is cosine over sine, but we also know that tangent of theta is equal to 1 over cotangent, and cotangent is equal to 1 over tangent. So if I take the reciprocal, I know that the cotangent of theta is just the square root of 21 over 2. That's the easiest way to do it. You could also do cosine over sine. So we have sine, cosine, tangent, cosecant. The only one we're missing, we also have cotangent, is secant. So secant of theta is equal to 1 over cosine of theta. So I have 1 over the square root of 21 over 5, which is 5 over the square root of 21. Again, we're not going to leave it like that. We always rationalize our denominator. So secant of theta is equal to 5 root 21 over 21. And now we have all four trig functions: sine, cosine, tangent, cosecant, secant, and cotangent. Our Pythagorean identities, I hope the rest of this triangle shows up, is where do they, okay, here we go. Where do they come from? So we know our Pythagorean theorem is a squared plus b squared equals c squared. Well, when we're tackling these identities, it's really important to understand that we're going to try to make that equal to 1 to understand some of the rules that happen with it. So if I were to take this, and I'm going to color code here a little bit. I'm going to divide by c squared to both sides, so that I then get a over c, all in parentheses squared, right? Because a squared over c squared is the same as a over c squared, plus b over c, parentheses squared, equals 1. Well, when you look at that, is that ratio, a over c, a trig function? So if we take a look at theta, a is our opposite side, and c is the hypotenuse. So a over c is my sine function. So I could say a over c is sine of theta squared, and b over c, so my adjacent over my hypotenuse, is my cosine. Equals 1. And that is our first Pythagorean identity. You will most likely see it in the next slide and in your textbook and in other problems like this, where it is sine squared of theta. This is equivalent. Plus cosine squared of theta equaling 1. Not always is it in parentheses like it's written here. Sometimes it's just sine squared of theta, because you're not actually squaring the angle, you're squaring the sine of that angle, and cosine squared of theta equaling 1, again, of that same angle, theta. So let's take a look at what our Pythagorean identities are. We could actually come up with all of them by setting it equal to 1. So if I had divided by a squared to all of these, I would have gotten different ratios, and they all come from our Pythagorean theorem. I just wanted to give some background before I just give you the formulas. So, as we just said, sine squared of theta plus cosine squared of theta is equal to 1. That theorem is used a lot, and there's more than one form of it. Meaning, if I just wanted to isolate sine squared and know what sine squared equals, I would subtract cosine squared to both sides, and I would get sine squared of theta is equal to 1 minus cosine. Again, these are equivalent identities. Same with if I wanted to isolate cosine squared. If I want to isolate cosine squared, I'd subtract sine squared to both sides, and I'd end up with cosine squared equaling 1 minus sine squared. As long as you know that sine squared of theta plus cosine squared of theta is equal to 1, these two are easy to manipulate, but I just wanted to show you in their alternate forms what they look like. Now again, in my previous slide, if I had divided everything by a squared or everything by b squared, the opposite side or the adjacent side, I would get the following identities, one of which is 1 plus tangent squared is equal to secant squared of theta. That would be if I divided by my opposite side. Again, this can be rewritten into the tangent squared equals secant squared minus 1. Again, all I did was subtract 1 to both sides. And if I divided everything in my Pythagorean theorem by b squared, I would get the other identity, which is 1 plus cotangent squared of theta equals cosecant squared of theta. I know this is a lot to kind of memorize at this time. Please feel free to rewind and rewatch these videos. But the ones that I'm starring are your kind of original, or what we like to call, those are those identities, but they can be rewritten. And this one it can also be rewritten to say cotangent squared of theta is equal to cosecant minus 1. So with that being said, let me show you how we can use it. So, given that the sine of theta is 3 over 5 and theta is an acute angle, in the future, we'll look at angles that aren't acute and we'll tackle that. But for right now, we're going to just assume that it's an acute angle, and we're going to find the value of cosine using our Pythagorean identity. So which identity here has sine? Well, it's the first one that we talked about, sine squared of theta plus cosine squared of theta equals 1. So I'm going to write that out. And I can just substitute in the sine of theta into sine squared of theta, and I'll square it. Again, sine squared of theta is equal to parentheses sine of theta squared. We saw that when we tried to prove the theorem. Or not tried, we did. So we have 3 over 5. All in parentheses squared plus cosine squared of theta equals 1. So I end up with 9 over 25 plus cosine squared of theta equaling 1. I'm going to subtract 9 over 25 to both sides. And I get that the cosine squared of theta is equal to 1 minus 9 over 25, get that common denominator of 25 over 25. So 25 minus 9 is going to give us 16 over 25. Now, this is not what it's asking for. It's asking for the cosine. So we're going to take the square root. And because we were told it's an acute angle, we know that my answer will be positive. We'll tackle more of that in the future sections. So I get that the cosine of theta is equal to the square root of 16 over 25 gives us 4 over 5. It's important here that we're using our trig identities, then that we're not trying to do this by drawing a triangle based on theta. It's really important that we are applying our identities and learning how to use them appropriately. Let's try another example. Here, I'm given that tangent of theta is equal to 3. And theta, again, is an acute angle. That's very important. We're going to find the value of cotangent and secant of theta using our trig identities. Now, we have a handful of identities in our little toolbox, if you want to say. We have our reciprocal identities, quotient identities, and we have our Pythagorean identities. Now, here's a little hint saying using the Pythagorean, but to find cotangent, the relationship between cotangent and tangent is their reciprocal identity. So the tangent, or sorry, I should say cotangent of theta is equal to 1 over tangent, or the reciprocal. So I end up with that the cotangent of theta is equal to 1 over 3. So that was kind of easy. But now secant. Secant and tangent aren't directly related unless we use our Pythagorean identities. So with our Pythagorean identity, we know that 1 plus the tangent squared of theta is equal to secant squared. So I have 1 plus our tangent squared. So I'm going to take what tangent equals, which is 3. And I'm going to square it, and that equals secant squared of theta. So I have 1 plus 9 equals secant squared of theta. So I get 10 equals secant squared. Again, I'm not done with this problem because this problem is asking for it to find just secant, not secant squared. So I'm going to take the square root again because we're given that it's an acute angle. I know it's going to be the positive root. So square root of 10 equals secant of theta. And that's all they're asking for. If you want to find all the rest of them, we could definitely do so. Finding our cosine being the reciprocal of secant. So I'd actually have 1 over root 10 or root 10 over 10. And then we can use other identities to find out what our sine and cosine are. But we weren't asked for them. All right. The other thing is kind of cool is to simplify expressions. Notice here, we're not going to use a calculator. Let me just make that clear. New calculator. Notice here that theta is replaced with an actual value. We have 53 degrees and 53 degrees. So theta is the same, which is very important. So the cosine of 53 degrees times secant of 53 degrees. The relationship between cosine and secant is that they're reciprocal identities. So I could rewrite this again because it's the same. Theta is now 53 degrees to be the cosine of 53 degrees times 1 over cosine of 53. Degrees, because that's what secant is. When you actually multiply, these cancel out, and my simplified expression is just 1. It is so important for you to show your work when doing these. Don't just tell me the answer is 1. Please show me how you're using your identities. All right, here we have radians. So here I have cosecant squared of theta, sorry, not theta, 10, pi over 10, so we're now dealing with radians, minus cotangent squared of pi over 10 radians. So again, we have the same theta value. And when we take a look at this, cotangent squared and cosecant squared are related. Remembering that the cotangent squared is equal to cosecant squared of theta minus 1. Remember, that's like that alternate example. So what I can do is I can write cosecant. A little more creative here, of pi over 10 minus, use those parentheses, and I'm going to substitute in. It's cosecant squared of pi over 10, again, the same theta value, that's very important here, minus 1. Our cardinal rule of algebra 2 is to distribute that negative, so I have cosecant squared of pi over 10 minus cosecant squared of pi over 10 plus 1, I didn't distribute. So again, this answer is 1. It's not always going to be that way, but it is for these two examples and for some of the ones in your homework. I hope this kind of helped because these two cancel out and help you understand how to use your identities. All right, as promised, we're going to also talk about cofunction identities. Think of the word cofunction where you might hear that. You hear that with cosine and cotangent and cosecant. That's not just by coincidence, but actually because they are cofunctions of each other. They're not reciprocals, but they are cofunctions. Cofunctions deal with the complement. Complementary angles are angles that have a sum of 90 degrees. So the value of a trig function for theta is equal to the cofunction of its complement. So if theta was, we'll make this easy, 30 degrees. The complement would be 60 because the sum would give us 90. So if I have the sine of theta, an equivalent function would be the cosine of 90 minus theta. So here, if the sine of 30 degrees is going to be equal to 90 minus 30 is going to give us 60. These are equivalent functions. Think of it this way. In a triangle, right, the sine is opposite over hypotenuse. So your opposite is 30 degrees. So opposite of 30 degrees over hypotenuse. Well, the adjacent of 60, the other angle, is that same opposite side of 30. So that's how they are related. So sine is equal to the cosine of 90 minus theta. Cosine is equal to the sine of 90 minus theta. Tangent is equal to the cotangent of 90 minus theta. Cotangent is equal to the tangent of 90 minus theta. Same with secant is equal to the cosecant of 90 minus theta. And cosecant theta is equal to the secant of 90 minus theta. This is important to remember. If theta is in radians, then we replace 90 degrees with pi over 2. So if I have the secant of pi over 4 degrees, then I know that is equivalent to the cosecant of pi over 2 minus pi over 4. Pi over 2 minus pi over 4, get that common denominator, and we know 1 half minus 1 fourth is still a fourth. So secant, that was probably a poor example. Let me go back and change it so it's not as easy to being equivalent. So the secant of pi over 3 is equal to the cosecant of pi over 2 minus pi over 3. Get a common denominator, so I'll get 3 pi over 6 minus, and we want 2 pi over 6. So the secant of pi over 3 is equal to the is equal to the cosecant of pi over 6. So you can kind of see that relationship. Making sure that when you're working in radians, your answer is in radians. You don't want to convert back to degrees. If you're working with degrees, we stay with degrees. So let's see some more examples. So the sine is 72 degrees. Let's find a cofunction with the same value. So the cofunction of sine is cosine. How easy is that to remember? Cosine. So we have the cosine of 90 degrees minus 72 degrees. Well, 90 minus 72 is going to give us 18 degrees. Make sure you don't write just 18 degrees. We want to make sure we write that it's the cosine of 18 degrees. These are equivalent functions. The cosecant of pi over 3. What is the cofunction of cosecant? Well, the cosecant would be secant. And here we're dealing with radians. So I have pi over 2 minus pi over 3. I just showed that work on the previous slide, but hey, can't hurt to go over again. So we have secant, and we get a common denominator of 6. So I have 3 pi over 6 minus 2 pi over 6, which is secant of pi over 6 radians. You don't need to write the word radians because it's assumed without the degree symbol, it's radians. All right, last but not least. For today's lesson, we're going to evaluate trig functions using a calculator. If you're looking at your calculator now, if not, go get it, hit pause and go get your calculator, whether it's scientific or graphing. I can actually send you a link so you can have a graphing calculator on your computer through Texas Instruments. But if you take a look, there's only three trig functions. There's normally only sine, cosine, and tan or tangent on your calculator. So in order to get the other three, our cosecant, secant, and cotangent, we have to use our reciprocal identities. Do not use the sine inverse, cosine inverse, or tangent inverse to find your other trig functions. They do not mean the same. Inverse is not the same as your reciprocal. So it's really important. Do not do that. So let's take a look at an example of what I mean. We also want to make sure we would check our mode for degrees or radians. I'll show us how to do that in a minute. So here's the problem we're going to first tackle, which is the secant of pi over 12. And we're going to estimate, normally we round to the third decimal place, sometimes fourth. It all depends on what the problem is asking for. We want to make sure that we know how to round and we do that correctly. So if we take a look, secant of pi over 12 radians, the reciprocal identity of secant is 1 over cosine. Again, 1 over cosine is not the same as cosine inverse. Please do not do that. So let's take a look how we can do that in our calculator. So I'm going to escape out of this. Then we're going to go to our calculator. So when you look at your graphing calculator, let's first check our mode. So the mode is over here, second, next to the second button. And we want to make sure, I can use my down arrow, that we are in radian measure. So that is highlighted. If we're working in degrees, you would move this over and then hit enter. But we want radian, so we're good there. And I can hit second, quit. So now I want to evaluate. 1 divided by, and I'm going to put it in parentheses, cosine of, and we're going to use our pi symbol, so second pi, over 12. If you're going to put it all in at once, it's really important to use the parentheses that everything is there. And I get 1.03527618. So if we rounded to the fourth decimal place, it would be 1.0353. All right. The other way you can do this, but I want to make sure we, actually, I'm not even going to show it because I think that's going to confuse us. So this is how you can calculate using the three trig functions that are given to us in our graphing calculator or our scientific calculator. So let's go back to our presentation and answer our question. Sorry. And that's approximately 1.0, and what do we say, 3.53 rounded to the fourth decimal place. Okay, it's really important that you give a couple decimal places because it's not one. It's 1.035, I'd be okay with, but 5.3 is really what a lot of times you're asked for. So here, I am going to now need to be in degrees. Don't forget to change your mode. So we're going to go back out. Let's keep them this time. Go to my calculator, and I'm going to go to mode, go down and switch to degrees. Enter. And quit. So now I wanted the sine of 56 degrees. Now that I'm in the correct mode, it will calculate and I get 0.8290. So if you wrote just 0.829. The other problem we had, I wish I could do a kind of a split screen. I wonder if it'll let me write now. Hold on. Hey, look at that. 0.8, what did we say? Could probably split the screen. I'm discovering things together, guys. 0.829. All right. Now secant, let's use our reciprocal identities. Reciprocal identity for secant is 1 over cosine, as we just talked about, of 42 degrees. So I'm going to type that in as 1 divided by parentheses cosine of 42 degrees, making sure I close the entire thing, enter, and I get approximately 1.345, and to four decimal places, 6, because of 3, it'll stay 6. All right, now with this problem, we have to change the mode. I know it looks like model, but it's an exclamation point. So let's go back to mode, giving us a lot of practice here. Radian, hit enter. All right, let me pull this up a little bit so you can see. And enter, and then we'll quit. And now we're gonna do our tangent of pi. Again, don't put 3.14, please use your pi symbol in your calculator. Divided by 5, close it. And we get 0.7265, and this one works out that we don't have to round either to the fourth decimal place because 4 is less than 5. And lastly, cotangent. Now this is a negative angle. This is kind of interesting going into what we'll be doing in our future. Cotangent is 1 over tangent. I have negative 2 pi over 7. We are still in radian mode, so we're good. So I can go in and type 1 over parentheses tangent of my pi. Here's a little hack if you didn't know this. If you mistype, instead of deleting it all, you can go second, insert negative 2 pi. And we want the whole thing. So again, I'm going to move my cursor so that I have everything where it should be. So I want negative 2 pi as my numerator. Close that parentheses. Divide by 7. Close the parentheses for tangent. Close the parentheses for the denominator. And I get negative 0.797, and we round up to 5 for the fourth decimal place. We know there can be negative angle measures. Negative 2 pi over 7 is less than negative a half. This would end up being in our fourth quadrant. We'll talk more about that in the future. And for now, this is where I'm going to leave us. We'll finish 5-2 when we get back from spring break. Your homework is going to be a very little bit in Delta Math and then for the most part in your textbook. I hope you all are doing well, and if you're interested, I'll see you in a Google Meet on Wednesday.